my pleasure this morning to introduce our moderator for our first panel, Mr. Al Grasso. Mr. Grasso is the President and Chief Executive Officer of MITRE Corporation, and today the panel will be looking at the industry perspective and looking at what any strategy must consider from an industry and industrial base aspect. Mr. Grasso is a graduate of the University of Massachusetts at Amherst and holds a Master in Computer Science from Worcester Polytechnic Institute. He served previously as a Senior Vice President and CIO at MITRE and as Technical Director of MITRE's Fort Monmouth Battlefield System Division. Under his leadership, MITRE has received several distinguished honors and awards: the Secretary of Defense Medal for Outstanding Public Service, the Air Force Association's Theodore von Karman Award, and the National Aeronautic Association's Collier Trophy. Mr. Grasso is an appointed member of the Defense Science Board and is chairman of the board of FCA International. Let's welcome Al Grasso, our moderator this morning.
Pete, thank you, and thank you to the U.S. Naval Institute and FCA for hosting this wonderful conference here. You've given us a great opportunity to hear from superb speakers such as the acting Deputy Secretary of Defense, Ms. Christine Fox, who spoke to the issues of fiscal uncertainty and the need to assure freedom of movement. She was followed by Admiral Henry Harris, who also spoke to the need for freedom of movement. But he did it in such an interesting way because he spoke to the balance that Secretary Fox also talked about with regard to the enablers in the force. Secretary Fox talked about the need to actually reduce force size, but at the same time to ensure that the force had the needed enablers to ensure its strength going forward. And then when Admiral Harris demonstrated through his presentation resiliency, moving from Google Glass to Apple iPads to paper to basically just doing it ad hoc, he demonstrated the need and the ability to use technology but not to depend on it. It was absolutely terrific. Richard Danzik and his panel emphasized the need to work well with our partners and with the coalition. And Dave Winogrand and his panel talked more about those enablers, which Secretary Fox emphasized. I was especially taken by Admiral Becker's remarks with regard to strategy, because as he talked about strategy, it was very clear that with commander's intent, you could do anything. So understanding your own strategy is very important. But what he also emphasized was the need through intelligence to understand the intent of others, the intent of the adversary, which is critically important. So as we talk about how strategy impacts the industrial base, I really have the privilege here to introduce a number of panelists that represent that base, and they're very interesting individuals. Amongst us here today, we have a chemist, we have a physicist, and we have an engineer. We have a naval nuclear surface warfare officer, we have a naval nuclear submarine officer. We have two Naval Academy graduates. I'll leave it to you to figure out who they are. but as I introduce them, you'll learn a little bit more. As we talk about strategy, I just wanted to share a story with you that I thought was quite compelling. The first time I had an opportunity to be involved in a significant enterprise-wide strategic planning meeting, before the meeting got started, they handed out bingo cards. And these bingo cards had a number, instead of numbers, there were words in the blocks. And what it was BS bingo, right? So the words that you would see in there were words like synergy, agility, transformation, and so forth. And what was very interesting about that session was whenever one of those words was used, the individual was called out. and needed to explain exactly what that meant. It's all too often that we use terms like that and don't really understand exactly what they mean. So I think today you will hear from these speakers a little bit more detail in terms of the importance of those things. It was attributed to Sir Winston Churchill when he said, "Gentlemen, we've run out of money, now we have to think, and thinking we are doing," as was demonstrated by the earlier speakers. But I did want to also bring to your attention a recent industry capabilities report that was published not long ago. It was based on the sector by sector, tier by tier review that was done by OSD, Brett Lambert, Assistant Secretary for Industry Affairs. And there were two fundamental recommendations that were in that report. One of those recommendations was the need to move more aggressively to selective low-rate procurement and block production. It was about 2 years ago that I had the opportunity to speak here at FCA West on a Defense Science Board study that we had on adaptability. And interestingly enough, there were a number of recommendations in there, and block production capabilities, the ability to evolve capability over time, was a critical recommendation. In addition, recognizing that technological advancement is critically important, but also could be very expensive to achieve, it was recommended in that report and is also recommended in this industry capabilities report that a hedging approach be applied to technological advancement, where in fact we're able to maintain a level of technical acumen within the industry by developing prototypes, but not necessarily committing to large buys, but being able to produce at scale when needed. And that was another recommendation coming from this report. So not to delay any further, I'd like to introduce our very first speaker that we have here, and that is Jeff Napoliallo. Jeff is the Vice President for Strategy and Business Development. Jeff is a Naval, U.S. Naval Academy graduate. Jeff was the Nuclear Surface Warfare Officer, and Jeff is the engineer. Jeff.
Oh, thank you. So first, I'd just like to say really appreciate the opportunity to join the panel. I was kind of contemplating joining the panel, and one of the things I kind of recognized there was a connection right out front. If you look at my career, I've spent 9 years in the Navy, 9 years in commercial industry, and then I've spent 12 years at Lockheed Martin, which has been a great. But one of my first opportunities out of the Navy is working for an organization much like MITRE, the Stanford Research Institute, so I feel a great connection to you. In my commercial career, I was mentioned to Ellen, the last job I had in my commercial industry before I joined Lockheed was actually doing a project for Textron. And my last job in the Navy was actually working in Newport News doing the overhaul for Enterprise. So I feel a kind of special connection with the community and the panelists here. My remarks are somewhat kind of informal. Strategic planning is everything, but the strategy is secondary. So I'm going to keep my remarks kind of high level. I think very shortly we're going to see kind of the disclosure of the National Maritime Strategy. I don't think anybody knows exactly what it's going to say, but I think we can anticipate what some of the elements are going to be. I think it won't be a radical departure from the past. It's going to talk about the need for forward presence. It's going to need for the enhancement of warfighting capability. It's probably going to have some elements of talking about the required ability to be interoperable and similar capabilities with some of our partners worldwide. And if you think about from an industrial perspective, at the broad strokes of what can we do as industry to prepare for that, I think some of the themes that we've been moving down towards as an industry and a government partnership are really kind of resonate with that. One, I think making sure that we have platforms that have sufficient capability and flexibility to be adapted over time. I think one thing that we've proven is that, if you look at aircraft, you look at aircraft carriers, which Mike's company builds, one of the things that make them such great assets is their inherent flexibility. And I think if you look at where the surface Navy and other elements of the sea services are moving, is kind of adopting the power of modularity, the power of adaptability. And I think that's really key. It's really key because it's allowing us to lower costs. It's really key because it's allowing us to build common products across platform. And frankly, it's really key, I think, in terms of providing a capability which is going to be essentially high cost to our adversaries to respond to. If you have a platform which is very predictable, you know what the capability was delivered with, you know what the capability it's going to have in 20 years, and adversarial, it's easy to plan for. But if we adopt and continue to push for open systems, for common systems, for modularity, and those type of architecture, I think what's going to help us on the affordability perspective, we're going to be able to do more with less. And on the other hand, it's going to require our competitors, our adversaries, to basically spend relatively more to be able to respond to an uncertain future. So I think that's really important. Many of the other things that we're talking about is in terms of interoperability with our allies. I think as a defense industrial base and our customers, we really have to continue to focus on enhancing the exportability of our products, getting more advanced capability into the hands of our international and trusted partners. That helps us not only in terms of leveraging their force structure, it helps us maintain and sustain the industrial base. And I think we have a lot more to do there. I think it'll have it be a big leverage point for us, and something that, you know, in prior job is working very closely with the administration to continue to push capabilities in those areas. So in terms of pushing for, you know, flexible platforms, those that can be adapted over time, there's clearly, you can't just have an adaptable platform, you have to continue to focus on those critical capabilities that we know are going to be required in the future. Advanced integrated air and missile defense capabilities, electronic warfare, autonomous systems, next generation ASW capabilities. We know, while the future is not exactly predictable, we know, we have conviction that those capabilities are going to be required in the future. And an area that would help us do better in investing for those is greater clarity. If you look at one thing that we can do going forward is recognizing, I think, there's probably not going to be more money. I mean, we can sit as an industry government team and kind of lament the fact that budgets are coming down, but the structural forces are going to continue to push that. So barring some unfortunate, perhaps unforeseen event, we're probably going to have to live with this environment for some period of time, in my personal opinion. So I think we have to recognize that that's an environment we're going to have to live with. And I think it's important for the government to recognize that as an industry, we're highly responsible. I think people, you think about our defense industry as not being as flexible as it is, but I can tell you, having worked in my last job as head of strategy within the company, supporting the leadership team, is the company is very responsive, and I know, I'm sure your companies are the same. We're making significant structural, we're unfortunately, we're being forced to take significant capacity out of the system. We're reducing our lengths of leadership. While we're trying to sustain our investment levels, it's a reality. With fewer sales, it's much more hard. It's harder to make those investments. So that's just a reality. But what we can do is, if we have greater clarity into those capabilities that are going to be required by our customers in the future, and we have a greater dialogue around those capabilities and find a way to partner more on the development of those capabilities, we'll be able to do far more with less. One of the areas of concern that I have is the nature of competition going forward. I recognize our customers are absolutely right in that they have to drive greater competition. Greater competition is certainly, they're realizing significant savings. But you have to recognize competition, particularly repeated competition for the same platforms and capabilities, what that's requiring us primarily to innovate is in business model. It's really not a catalyst for capability evolution. It's more in its business model. How can we structure the organization? How can we take out costs? How can we use lower skilled labor? How can we outsource more? That's really the innovation that kind of repeated competitions occur. And it also requires us to shift more and more resources to proposal writing. And those type of activities, while of value and certainly lowering costs, it's not allowing us to invest the degree we would like in those next generation capabilities. These repeated competitions, they also have the effect that you're either beginning a competition or ending one. It's really requiring us, particularly the nature of competition, we're not in an environment where we really can collaborate with our customers around the next generation and evolving our capabilities. And if you look at those programs, whether it was missile defense or many other capabilities, where we've done the leap ahead work, it's when we have an industry team and a customer team with free flow of information working together towards common goals. That's when we get the technology leap aheads. And if you're in constant competition mode, predominantly for capabilities that are out there, you're forcing the team apart. You're limiting, not only you're shifting resources away from research and development, you're limiting the industry government team to collaborate in a manner which we've demonstrated in the past as the way to move ahead. So I think we've taken a lot of cost. We recognize the absolute need to that. But I think as we look forward to the next 5 years, if we continue to use the same levers and the same methods to drive out costs, I think we can find ourselves in a position where we've been forced to invest less as an industry, where we have less connection and a less integrated development focus than we have in the past. And I think we'll find ourselves kind of in a poorer position to respond to what I personally believe is going to be a rapid escalation and proliferation of advanced technologies, which we're going to have to face. So I think we're getting to the point where our industry government team, we've cut a lot of fat out. We're really getting to the point where we're going to cut into muscle. And I think we have to have a dialogue around what is really we're trying to achieve with our competitive strategies, and find a way, if there's a smarter way, that we can better collectively position for the future. So that's really kind of the focus of my remarks.
Jeff, thank you very much. You know, what I think I got from what you said is it's about team, it's about industry government working together, it's about, you know, increasing the dialogue and ensuring clarity in that dialogue. It's about increasing efficiencies through the business model that's able to deliver more to mission,
right,
as opposed to more to overhead. It's about flexibility and adaptability, and we know that open systems architectures offer that opportunity. And it's about creating more capable partners and being able to invest in the technologies, not only for ourselves, but for more capable partners.
Exactly.
Thank you very much. It gives me great pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Ms. Ellen Lord, who is the President and Chief Executive Officer of Textron Systems. Ellen is our chemist. Ellen is also our innovator. She has done some very interesting work in developing a new family of thermoplastics. So, Ellen?
That goes way back.
Thank you.
All right, thank you. I just have a few slides I'm going to use here today. I want to thank you, Al. I want to thank AFSEA. I want to thank the Naval Institute for giving me the opportunity to represent Textron and Textron Systems. If we go to the next slide, I just wanted to set the context. I come from a multi-industry company. I have sister divisions like Cessna Aircraft, Bell Helicopter. The $2 billion company that I have responsibility for has products and services ranging from precision weapons to electronic warfare to wheeled armored vehicles to different vessels to unmanned aircraft systems. So in the next slide, I just have highlighted the different areas that I want to talk about. There are a few key areas that I am very, very passionate about, because I believe they are critical to maintaining the health and the competitiveness of the U.S. defense industrial base, something that's very important to us all. If we sit back and think about the environment we're operating in, I think we really need to look within to find the strengths to stay very competitive. And with our company, like I think all of the other industry partners out here, we want to be there. We want to be an enduring partner for the fleet, for the field. So how are we going to do that? I have a hypothesis that I think the use of commercial best practices is really going to help us get there. So if I look around and see what some of those commercial best practices are that we can take and apply, I think to begin with, it's understanding our customer, understanding the mission sets, understanding the requirements. Also, making sure that we really follow all the commercial businesses out there in terms of understanding operational efficiency. I saw a great example of that yesterday here in San Diego. After flying from the East Coast, where there are big snow and ice storms happening yesterday and today, I had the opportunity to come out here to great sun. Pete very, very nicely arranged for me to go take a tour of the Independence, the LCS right here in the harbor. And Captain Dave Back spent 90 minutes with me walking through that vessel. Incredibly, incredibly impressive in terms of the efficiency that the Navy has realized. Far fewer than 100 individuals manning that vessel, all cross-trained, skill sets, they're incredible. A huge amount of data fusion going on to provide information to allow a lot of cross-tasking. That's what we in industry are trying to do as well, and it's a great example to follow. We need to have efficient product development. Again, there aren't going to be a lot more dollars out there. And I again look to some of my commercial sister companies in terms of what they're doing. One recent accomplishment that I want to be able to emulate is what Cessna did with a new light attack aircraft. They came up in 24 months, actually less than 24 months, going from a clean sheet of paper to a flying aircraft, one that really is going to provide operational efficiency for the warfighter, operating at less than $3,000 per hour. How'd they do that? They looked at all those parts in inventory today. They have a bill of materials that uses 80% subsystems, components that are already in inventory. So reuse of commercial technology, something that we can learn from. So what are we trying to do in some of my space? We're looking at what we have for existing platforms and saying, how do we stretch them a little bit further? We take tactical unmanned aircraft systems such as Shadow. We take our very precious IRAD dollars and we look at how do we bridge from that tactical space to the strategic space. How do we add a little bit more room for fuel? How do we add more room for payloads to all of a sudden, again, give an hourly value to the services to allow them to complete missions that they couldn't do before at that same cost? All right, another area that I believe is very, very important is the use of commercial off-the-shelf technology. We can really keep pace with commercial product introductions by taking what's out there. We also can reduce cost. We can improve sustainability. I think the Navy, again, is really a leader in this with what they've done with CANES, the Consolidated Afloat Networks and Enterprise Services. Again, what we need to do in industry is do more of this. So, talked about technology development. The return on investment. Just as the services are really wrestling how to bring all the warfighters back home and keep capability, industry needs to understand how we're going to be competitive in this constrained environment. We have to make very, very smart decisions about where we're investing. And how do we do that? We look forward to what the warfighter is going to need. Some of the things we're trying to do is look at the constraints in place and understand what is needed in terms of simulation and training. So we're putting our dollars into what we can do using commercial technologies to bring that to the warfighter. We just made two acquisitions in December of companies that have a lot of commercial experience in terms of aircraft simulation. We want to take their best practices, bring them back to the services, and allow us to move forward very affordably. So we know we're not going to have new manned aircraft starts, but we also know we have to keep the force trained. We want to do that in a very, very cost-effective way. We also want to make sure that when we introduce new products, they come in a very mature state at high technology readiness levels. How do we do that? We reuse systems. So, an example of that, we have almost 1 million hours in our unmanned aircraft systems, very mature command and control systems that go along with that. Why not take those and bring those to the sea? We have an unmanned surface vessel that utilizes what we've learned in the air domain. So we are able to very affordably bring a mature system to surface warfare. All right. One of the things that we know is that in the defense arena, often there's critical technology that needs to be developed that we cannot justify the return on investment in terms of a business case to our boards of directors. Why is that? It's because quantities, volumes are low. There are critical areas where we need the government to understand that their discretionary dollars would be very, very well spent because industry cannot afford to develop. One of those areas are engines for unmanned aircraft systems. We find that really the Achilles heel of any aircraft is the engine. We know that the failure mechanism in a lot of UAVs out there is a power plant that's not as predictable, as reliable. We in industry are putting a lot of our money into that, but I think there's huge payback if government does the same. Now, we are only as strong as our talent pool is. And you read a lot these days about people not wanting to go into the defense sector because of a concern of funding and being able to work on really interesting things. How's industry attacking that? We're looking at that in terms of the leverage of a multi-industry company. We have a target to hire 80% right out of school or the military. Why is that? We want to train up individuals so they understand our company, our technologies. We do that not only domestically, but we do it internationally. We are finding that we need to reach out when kids are just starting college and to develop internship programs where essentially we have a 3 to 6 month extended job interview that goes two ways. The kids are looking at us, we're looking at them. By the time you process hundreds of these people through, they're ready to graduate, you know what you're getting, they want to join. And oh, by the way, I can only entice so many people, so working in the corporation I do, I can reach out as those students progress to become employees. I can reach out to Bell Helicopter. I can reach out to Cessna. That cross-fertilization is really, really a strength. I think this is why multi-industry companies are very, very important to the defense sector of the government, and we need to make sure that we provide incentives for corporations to still play in the defense arena along with the commercial areas. All right, obviously a lot of us are spending enormous energy looking for business overseas. My business, for instance, is 35% international right now. Some of that is direct commercial sales, but for a lot of obvious reasons, a lot of that is foreign military sales. Foreign governments want the transparency of going through the US government. A lot of countries don't have really the sophistication to go direct commercial sales. These dollars are what's really keeping the US industrial base for defense afloat. A concern that industry has, that I particularly have, is that the services are getting stuck as the middlemen a lot of the time. And it's adding a lot of time and cost. We have end customers that have money to spend today that are waiting 24, 36 months to get their products because of our process. And everybody within the process, within the government, thinks they're doing the right thing, they're trying to be compliant, but the system isn't really geared to what those ultimate customers need. So what does that mean? We have examples where we have provided the exact same product to one customer, have another customer coming wanting to buy that same product a couple months later, and the services that we are working through are required to get more DCMA, DCAA audits, carrying things out 6, 8, 12 months. That's leading to very dissatisfied ultimate customers, and frankly, it's driving customers to our competitors, to other nations. There's another piece to that. About a month ago, I was meeting in DC with the ambassador from a key Mideast country who's spending a lot of money internationally on defense products. And he told me that his country would really like to buy more U.S. goods. In fact, he said, we are buying inferior technology knowingly. Why is that? He looked at me and said, Ellen, why won't your government leadership come and sit down with us? Why won't they advocate a little bit for industry? I'm getting phone calls all the time saying that country XYZ has their leader, has their defense minister here, saying they're not going to leave until we get a deal. We are doing deals that we don't want to do because it's too hard to do business with the U.S. I think we all need to urge our government officials to lean forward a little bit more because there's a very unlevel playing field out there. And I'm talking about everything being compliant here. It's just a concern that we don't have that same level of advocacy. So finally, I can't help myself, but I've got to talk just a little bit about acquisition and procurement. I believe that the government is looking for better ways to do things. We hear a lot about better buying power 2.0 and so forth. How can the government really be more efficient? I think a large part of this is communication. Industry wants to take those precious discretionary dollars and put them into products and services that the warfighter needs. But we need to understand what those are. We need to have the time with senior leadership in the services to understand what your capability gaps are. What are those missions that you really need to execute? We need to understand this so that we can put our dollars the right place and end up with useful technology. So before we get the RFP launched out there, we need more ability to come in and have discussions, more industry days, more understanding of what the path forward is. We need more CRADAs. These are great ways to work together. We each have skin in the game. Finally, I believe that from a procurement point of view, there could be a lot more use made of fixed price contracting. Right now, we have a lot of cost-plus different contracts out there that I don't believe are driving best value. There are many areas where industry would do better to bid fixed price, have our feet held to the fire, and be able to deliver. So, to conclude, commercial industries operate in a fast-paced, highly competitive environment with product innovation and development. While our defense industry is different in many ways, I think we can extract a lot of the best practices from the commercial sector to really help drive efficiencies in product development and cycles. We also can look for ways in which industry and government can work better together to deliver better solutions affordably and quickly, and to continue setting the standard for innovation here and abroad. There's a lot of opportunity. I think we need to look within on how we deliver on that. Thank you.
Ellen, thank you very much for those insightful remarks. I won't try to summarize them because you did a great job summarizing them for me on your slide, but I would like to, you know, maybe emphasize two points that you made. One, you know, I think Jeff and you have made some common points. Your topic on acquisition, which I found very interesting, you know, it is said that the government is unique in that the closer it actually gets to a contract award, the more distance it has between that organization that it's going to award a contract to, mm-hmm. which is the exact opposite as we do business in other places. So that's just the dialogue, again, becomes mm-hmm. very, very important. And the other point that I'd like to emphasize, you talk about the talent. I couldn't help but bring this with me, which is a Washington Post article it's a little dated now, October of 2013. It's entitled, Young Workers Souring on Federal Careers, subtitled, Disillusioned by Furloughs and Cuts, Fast-Moving Millennials with High-Tech Skills are Finding Opportunities in Private Industry More Attractive. We will not maintain the kind of competitiveness that we hope to maintain if this remains the case. So thank you for your insightful remarks. I now have the pleasure of introducing our next speaker, Mike Petters, who is the President and Chief Executive Officer of Huntington Ingalls Industries. Mike was our physicist in the group. He is also a Naval Academy graduate and is our nuclear submarine warfare officer. Mike, thank you for joining
us. Well, let me just say that the last time I cracked a physics textbook, physics was still doing Newtonian physics. So I think I probably you do the career path a disservice by saying I'm a physicist. And Jeff, I would point out that your time on Enterprise, in Newport News, there's only two kinds of people that have worked in the shipyard at Newport News, and that is people who did work on Enterprise and people who will work on Enterprise. And now that the Secretary has declared that CVN 80 will also be named Enterprise, we know that will be the case for the next several decades as well. And so that's an interesting connection there. And I really appreciate your comments about the multiple business piece of what you're doing, because I think everybody in the sector right now is trying to figure that out. Some companies like ours are a lot more of a pure play for defense ship, Navy shipbuilding and Coast Guard shipbuilding than maybe some of the other companies in the audience today. But every one of us is sitting here trying to figure out how do we take the capabilities that we have and apply them to some of those other hard problems that other people have. And so Textron has done a great job, and that's one of our role models for doing that. So congratulations to you all. I think the panel discussion this morning is about the industrial base, and I think we ought to clear up a couple of things to start with. We don't build destroyers so that we can have jobs in Mississippi. We build destroyers because destroyers need to be somewhere, and they need to be able to do certain things. Now, the alignment between what that destroyer does when it's on station and the skill set that you need to be able to produce that, whether it's in the supply chain or in the workforce, which both Jeff and Ellen have talked a little bit about already, there's an alignment there between the industrial-based capability and the product capability on station that requires a lot of investment. A lot of investment. And a lot of times when the argument comes around to the industrial base, it starts to sound like, well, we need to build another ship because we've got to preserve jobs. That's really not the case. We need another ship because we need freedom of the seas and common access and all that sort of thing. We have a momentum in the industrial base that can affordably support that requirement. When we start to break that, things start to become unaffordable, and then requirements become unattainable. One of the things that I think that has been characterized by the strategy over the past, at least from my standpoint, and I'm not a Navy strategist at all. I'm a shipbuilder, been in the business for 27 years after my time in the Navy, and so geopolitics is not my area. But what I also have is I have a ski boat. And I suggest to you that everybody who has ever had a boat, whether it's a big one or a small one, always wants 2 more feet, right? Because the thing that gives you the flexibility in the platforms that makes the most sense is volume. And volume at sea, and frankly, sustainable volume at sea, survivable sustainable volume at sea, is really what the U.S. Navy has been all about for all of the decades of my life and for several decades before that. I look out my window today and I see the Enterprise, and we're taking the Enterprise apart. And right behind the Enterprise is the Ford. And, there doesn't a day go by that I don't look out there and I see the Enterprise and I see the Ford and I see the last 50 plus years of Navy history and the next 50 plus years of Navy history sitting there one pier apart from each other. And it's really an amazing thing. And what do those two ships have in common? They have volume at sea. They have survivable, sustainable volume at sea. And so whatever our strategy is going to be, however it comes out, I think that to give the flexibility that we need, this idea of survivable, sustainable volume at sea is going to allow for the flexibility of missions that we today, in 2014, cannot contemplate that Ford will be carrying out. Ford will be decommissioned in 2065 or so. Well, I would say everybody write down on an envelope a mission that you think the Ford might be doing in 2060, right? We don't know. We don't have any idea. We're really smart, but we don't know what that is. But we know it'll be able to do it because it's survivable, sustainable volume at sea. And I think that's the case whether you're talking about aircraft carriers or submarines or destroyers or amphibs. And how we got that survivable, sustainable volume at sea is really a great story of alignment between the Navy requirements and the industrial base support. You know, in the industrial base, a lot of us talk about this all the time. We have, in our business, we have 5,000 suppliers in all 50 states. And these are suppliers that, some of them have been suppliers to our company for decades. And in the same way that the ships are not doing the same things today that they were doing 30, 40, 50 years ago, these same suppliers that have been in business for that long are not doing the same things. And when you can go and talk with them about where we're going, what the future holds, they're able to make the kinds of investments in either their technology or their tooling or their people to be able to support the requirement that you're going to have to place on them in the future. I mean, there's a couple of suppliers that, you know, of the 5,000, I would venture to say the vast majority of them do that. You know, they're always ready to respond to our ability to provide some sort of view of where this is going to go. Now, the challenge in the supplier base is that we're heading to a place where we have been competing to monopoly. You know, in our submarine supply chain, for instance, nearly 80% of our suppliers are sole source. Now, we're able to manage that cost because in the submarine business, we're able to go to them and say, we're going to buy 8 ship sets of this material. And so you, as a supplier, now have the view of where you're going to go for the next several years because you're going to be providing ship sets worth of this material. But it is a sole source relationship, and so that's something that my company has to manage and our partner has to manage. In the case of the carrier, for instance, when we new class of carrier for the Ford, we went to the supply chain and we opened up the window and said, let's have some competition. We ended up with, on the first ship, we have less than 30% of our suppliers are sole source. Robust competition. The next ship is the Kennedy. We haven't signed that contract. We've been doing some advanced procurement and some advanced construction, but we haven't signed the detailed design and construction contract yet. And our plan now is we may not sign that for another year, which we're already 5.5 years since we signed the Ford contract. We're going to be more than 6, somewhere between 6 and 7. How many of those suppliers that competed on the Ford are still going to be there? Not very many. In fact, our estimate is that we're going to be more than 70% sole source on the Kennedy, which is going to make a big challenge for us in terms of how do you engage that supply chain and do that in some affordable way. And I think that does then speak to something, Jeff, you brought up about this whole idea of competition. You know, I guess what I see is that as taxpayers, we would really like for the Pentagon to be, you know, a big box store like a Walmart, where Walmart would actually have, you know, lowest prices every day, right? And the store has the leverage to go and make all of that sort of thing. The problem is that, and there's probably a lot of stuff that the Pentagon buys that can be bought that way. The problem is that the stuff that goes out to the warfighter, the soldiers and sailors who are in harm's way, ain't like that. You know, it requires this alignment between the capability of folks on the deck plate with the soldier and the sailor and the requirements in between. You can't solve that by just saying, we're going to go and compete all this stuff. You've got to have that intimacy. You know, and when the volumes of products that you're buying, when you're moving from, even in shipbuilding, you're buying 8, 9, or 10 submarines at a time, you know, 9 or 10 destroyers at a time, and then you're going to go buy one carrier or one amphib. When you reduce the volume set down to one at a time, competition is not your solution. You know, competition is absolutely sand in the gears, if you will. It'll slow things down. It'll actually keep you from getting the work done that needs to be done. You may save, in the course of trying to run a competition, you may actually save a little bit on the margins of a subsystem somewhere, but you will lose money on the overall product. And I think that's not my opinion. I mean, that's, I think Rand did a study on this several years ago where they looked at the UK, and they talked about the challenge of competition in a low volume environment actually adds cost. Mm-hmm. You know, and I think that it's been a while since I've read that study, but I see that's where we're headed here, at least in some of the work that I'm doing. So we talk about the supply chain. Well, you can talk about the workforce too, and Ellen, you talked about this very eloquently, so I'm just gonna try to pile on if you don't mind. I met the other day with a guy by the name of Jason Ayers, who is a machinist in our shipyard in Newport News. Jason's father is a foreman in the shipyard at Newport News. Jason's grandfather worked in Newport News, and Jason's great-grandfather worked in that shipyard. So Jason's a fourth-generation shipbuilder. We actually have fifth and sixth-generation shipbuilders, but the Ayers family has been working inside of Newport News for 118 of its 128 years. Now, I can tell you for certain that the things that we asked Jason to do today are nothing like what we asked his great-grandfather to do. Mm-hmm. Right, so this isn't about preserving these jobs so people can keep doing the same things they've been doing for a long time. This is about making sure that you keep the momentum going so that you don't have to restart all of this. Because if we have to restart a family like Jason Ayers to get back into this business at some point, I think you're gonna find that the challenges that we have are the ones, Al, that you mentioned. That folks are gonna step back and say, how interesting is this? You know, one of the things we talk about in our business all the time is that, you know, as a public company, we are in the middle of the fight for capital all the time. And if you want to be a healthy company, you have to be able to attract talent, you have to be able to attract capital, and you have to be able to attract technology. If you can't do that, if you cannot do that in a sustainable way, you ultimately will not be a healthy company. And so, being able to have a business where a guy like Jason Ayers, his father says, you know, working in the shipyard would be a great way to have a career, that's a healthy sign for your business. And to step back and have people wonder about, is this really a business to go into, you know, is not healthy for the industry. We have in our business today, we have 5,000 engineers and designers. They average somewhere a little bit over 10 years of experience with the company. And no different from you all, I'm sure. If you go outside of the aerospace industry and you start talking to other companies who have that kind of an asset in their business, we have 5,000 engineers. We're talking about STEM all the time, right? We talk about that all the time. How do you take that capability, and turn it into something more than what it already is? You know, especially in an environment where we're not sure what's going to happen in the next three to five years. That's a really big challenge for us. And it's one that I actually, I worry about that one probably as much as anything, is how do you make sure that you attract the people to this business in a way that they can see, you know, they're not going to, our employees don't change careers. You know, we're not out looking to recruit people that are going to be with us for 3 years and then go somewhere else. Our benefit plans are not set up for that. We have 1,000 people in our business today who have been with us for over 40 years. We call them master shipbuilders. That's 40 years of unbroken service. The only excuse we give you is if you join the military. If you go to the service, serve your country, and you come back to us, we'll say, okay, that's fine. But if you go anywhere else and you come back, we thank you for coming back, but you no longer count towards the Master Shipbuilder program. We have a big dinner for these folks and their spouses, and we give them a blue jacket. The master's already had a green jacket, so we give them a blue jacket. We put a sticker on their hard hat and say, you are a Master Shipbuilder. You are a mentor and a role model for the new folks that we're hiring. That's the bones of our business. This business works because it's aligned with why we need that destroyer on station in the Malacca Straits. And what I'm worried about is that if you make a hard left turn on whether or not we need the destroyer in the Malacca Straits, you're going to leave the industry out here trying to figure out how do they recover. If you've ever done any sort of rowing, you know that when the shell is at rest, to get the shell up to speed requires a lot of strokes and a lot of energy. But once the shell is up to speed, then it's just a matter of riding it and keeping it and sustaining it. Where we have been is we have an industrial base that has been up to speed. If you decide to turn hard left, you're going to be bringing the shell to a stop and you're going to be trying to restart it. And you got to wonder, do we have the energy, the resources to restart it? And so that's really the nuts and bolts of how the industrial base aligns with the maritime strategy. So with that, I think I probably said too much, but I'm happy to turn it back over to you, Al, and let you lead us through some questions. Well,
Mike, thank you very much for your comments. Let me offer just a couple things in terms of what you said. You know, you used the concept of survivable, sustainable volume at sea, and I can't help but see how well that aligns to Admiral Gortney's remarks just yesterday with regard to his optimized force readiness plan, where fundamentally your objectives are exactly the same as his objectives, and that is, as he calls it, A-naught, availability of mission capability, maximizing that capability. So I think, you know, your comments are very well aligned. And, you know, I think all of us have talked about the talent in the workforce and in STEM. The one remark that I would make there is, when it comes to STEM and when it comes to engineers, we are not going to win globally on quantity, right? China is graduating 800,000 engineers a year. India graduates somewhere between 300,000 to 400,000 engineers a year. The United States has been pretty level at around 130,000 to 140,000 engineers a year. We're not going to win on quantity, but we can and we should win on quality, which we have been winning for years, for forever, quite frankly. And as opportunities dissipate, if you will, quality will diminish. We cannot allow that to happen. So thank you, and I applaud you for what you're doing in terms of maintaining that workforce. So with that, what I'd like to do is open the floor up for questions. And as you think about your questions, I do have a question for our panelists here that I'd like to start with. But I'd like you all in the audience here to think of those questions and feel free to bring those questions forward. The first question that I have for all of you is, you know, speed of response and adaptability has been talked a lot and is likely to be a key element of the maritime strategy going forward. So what do you need to do to support these requirements of adaptability, of agility, if you will? Now, that's a bingo. That's a bingo word. But is it getting harder or is it getting easier for you given this kind of environment?
Sure, well, I'll start. I think a lot of things we talked about, I think a lot of the inherent structure that we've been put in place over the past 20 years is really kind of a somewhat of an impediment to moving fast. I mean, as I talked about before, you know, one of the hallmarks of our kind of industrial base is that, you know, we are structured, you know, we all work for public companies, and by design, you know, we have a whole series of stakeholders that we respond to, one of which is obviously the customer. So, If the structure's there, if the incentives are there, and we get the clear direction from our customers, we've demonstrated that we can be highly responsive. We've also demonstrated, even on some of our own investment, where we've demonstrated responsibility. I'll just give an example. Is one of the programs or capabilities you might have observed is one of my former jobs. I worked in strategy and business development. And our WeGo business in New York, and actually Marilyn Houston, who's our now CEO, was there running the business at the time. And we made a commitment to bring the autonomous capability in our KMAX platform, which is our autonomous logistics systems you might have seen that we deployed with the Marine Corps in demonstration. And basically we're able to demonstrate autonomous logistics capability, and I can't remember exactly the amount, but it was several million pounds of equipage that we were able to deploy overseas and take soldiers off the road and save lives. We did that, all that initial investment we did on speculation. There's no specific requirement, there was no specific program, but we thought two things. One is we recognized that we thought that was an urgent need and a capability that we thought would save lives. We thought it was a capability that would position our company for the future. And we did that on speculation, essentially. Now, ultimately, we were able to work with the different services and have been able to craft several COCO models. So it was basically contractor-owned and contractor-operated in demonstration Marine Corps. But that's an example where, you know, as a company, we saw a need. We saw a future business opportunity, even though there wasn't an immediate one, and frankly, a capability that we thought was really required by the warfighter. And I'm really proud. I think that's an example of where, and I'm sure your companies have many examples like that too, where we are willing to put our own investment out and get out there. But you know, in that particular example, and many times, it's very hard for us to make those long-term business cases. Close. While it's in our DNA, we want to do those things, we want to make those investments. You know, you can see time and time again where industry has made those speculative investments. A lot of times where we thought there was an incredible need, essentially the formal programs really didn't materialize over a relatively short period of time. So I think as an industry, we demonstrated the capability to do that. There's a willingness to do that. Is again, I think our customer has to, you know, continue to evolve the mechanisms that and the contracting structures and the responsiveness from their side that will allow us and frankly encourage us to make even more of those type of investments in the future.
Thank you, Jeff. It's great to see Lockheed Martin leaning forward on these kinds of critical mission capabilities. So thank you very much. Ellen, any thoughts?
Al, I think we can definitely be adaptable. The question is how effectively adaptable are we? And it comes back to some fundamentals of communication. Because when we adapt, we want to get to the end game. And we can adapt effectively if there's an ongoing dialogue as to where the Navy's going. And frankly, that's why we're all here, right? To talk with one another and understand not only through these formal sessions what is going on, what's on people's minds, but probably even more importantly, all of those side conversations that are happening, you know, beginning of the day, during the day, after. And if we effectively communicate, then we can put all that energy into doing things that get us somewhere. So we all have to adapt. We just want to be smart adapters.
Thanks, Ellen.
Well, I'd say that you know, there's probably not anything more sobering than meeting with the owners of your business and having them ask you, what are you going to do with my cash? You know, when all of our businesses, we do well, we create, you know, we have a contract, we execute the contract, we invest, we do all kinds of things, but at the end of the day, we're generating cash. And the fundamental question that our shareholders say is, what are you going to do with it? And shareholders would love for you to invest in things that create the kinds of returns that they can't get somewhere else. And you know, shareholders are also very, very understanding that R&D is no sure thing. You know, Jeff has a great example there. I mean, you know, and I like to think about I haven't cracked a physics book in a long time, but one of the things I learned in physics was sometimes the most interesting discussions are when you think about the boundary conditions. Mm-hmm. You know, you pick an extreme example to see how the system would behave at the boundary, and think about, let's do a little thought experiment. You know, Einstein liked them, so they must be okay. Imagine for a minute that somehow one of those 5,000 engineers that I have came in one day and said, you know, I just figured out how to put the power that's generated by the Ford class reactors into the volume of a suitcase. How many more ships would we build? How many more ships would my company build because I figured that out? How hard would it be for that idea to become that intellectual property inside of our business? How hard would that be to carry that forward to the system, and now system writ large? You're talking about operators, you're talking about requirements and acquisition people, you're talking about citizens of the United States represented by their Congress. How hard would all of that be to get us to a place where the Navy could actually have ships that were, you know, in this imaginary world, powered by something the size of a suitcase? Think about that. I mean, you can actually wrap your head around a tree a few times thinking about all of the obstacles from the guy walking in and saying, hey, I've got a great idea, to it actually showing up in the fleet. You know, and I think what happens when you have that kind, when you can come up with those that long litany of things that get in the way of that, when your shareholders and your owners turn to you and say, what are you going to do with my cash? It becomes really hard for you to say, I'm going to go invest in that suitcase. That's really hard. And so, you know, because their view is, you know, if you don't have a really good investment, why don't you just give the cash to me and I'll go figure out what to invest it in? You know, because I'm a better investor than you're a great company, you're a great defense contractor, you're a great shipbuilder. I'm a great investor. And so if you don't have a good investment, I'll go make the investment. And that is why, frankly, I think that there is a legitimate concern, and Frank Kendall has talked, I think he's exactly right, that there is a real legitimate concern that R&D is going to be stressed over the next several years because of this. Because, you know, in order to make the case that you're going to invest in those kinds of things that are going to improve the capability, improve the warfighting capability, you've got to actually feel confident that you can overcome a lot of these obstacles that we think we can put in the way. And, you know, my challenge to the all of us in the industry, whether you're on the contractor side, the supplier side, or on the government side, is let's fight harder for that cash. You know, let's, as we generate cash and have a chance to redeploy it, let's fight harder for it. Whether you're in the place of creating an obstacle for it, or you're in the place of creating the ideas for what to use it for, let's go fight for it. Because if we can keep that in, the sailors and soldiers that are in harm's way will benefit. And if we lose that fight, then we will lose sailors and soldiers.
Mike, thank you. I think you're spot on. You know, Frank Kendall seems to be taking a page out of Bill Perry's approach, which he implemented in the 70s, again, a hedging approach where they made technology investments, but they weren't brought to fruition until a decade later, because it was then that they actually had the money to bring them to fruition.
I do think that we talked about it a little while ago too, is there is a bit of a cross purpose here, where if you really want to go and improve the R&D piece of this, you have to actually be thoughtful about whether competition is what you want or not.
Right.
Right? Because let's go back to my power plant suitcase. If I walk in with this power plant in a suitcase, and I have to put it into a system where the number one concern is how are we going to create competition around this IP?
Yeah.
How are we going to do that? Right? So those two things sometimes, not always, and maybe not even the majority of time, but sometimes they are at odds with each other and actually push Absolutely. Them. They're like north poles of the magnets and push opposite.
So you're getting to a topic of disruptive innovation, right? And it's big change. It's big change inside an organization. It's big change in your customer base. Let me ask Jeff and Elaine, how do you deal with disruptive innovation, something that has the potential for big change? And how do you invest in it, and how do you build on it, and how do you sell it? Because that change also threatens many other things that are out there.
You know, I think that you need to take groups and let them go off by themselves and do the new and different things. And I think that's where the disruptive technology change comes in. You can't have a homogenous group in terms of always doing the same types of things. And I think the human spirit being what it is, competition is a fabulous thing. And when you have groups doing things differently, and this is a special project, and hey, we're trying to take this new technology and make it work, and you know that next year you're going to be competing for those investment dollars because the boards of directors are always going to come in and say, you know, why should I keep your business versus this other one? I think it's through giving small groups the opportunity to go and really capitalize on that disruptive change and keep that competitive element, which is a powerful thing, I think, with your employees.
Yeah. Very good. Jeff, any?
Yeah, I'll just, excuse me. In many of the jobs I've had in Lockheed is, I've had, an opportunity to work in a lot of areas of innovation. I ran our new ventures organization, which was to try to find opportunities like the suitcase that Mike talked about. So I've really spent a lot of time studying it. And one of the things I found is that there's no lack of great ideas within our organization. They're absolutely not. Is the number of brilliant ideas that, in our case, nearly 70,000 technicians and engineers come up with is mind-boggling. The challenge, the biggest challenge is frankly the challenge that Mike talked about, is how do you take those ideas and how do you connect the dots between the innovative idea, the capability that you know can have a big impact, and the ultimate return that you have to deliver. You know, as a business, you know, we have four primary stakeholders that somewhat unique is that we have to absolutely provide value to our shareholders. We absolutely have to provide value to our employees. We absolutely have to provide strategic value and positioning for our future. And we have to ultimately provide value to our customers. We have to balance value creation across those four dimensions. And getting from that innovation, that idea that you knew could revolutionize, to the point where you can deliver value on those four dimensions is the hardest one. And frankly, a lot of the way the defense industry is architected and the ability to build that surety in the plan so that we can go to the shareholders and say, we want to make this investment because we know we can balance the value creation drivers, including yours, and deliver on that and making this investment today. If we can't connect those dots, well, unfortunately, we have an inability to make that case. And that's really the driver. And one of the things I was, you know, if you go back to Mike's suitcase example, in addition to all the impediments that you talk about, another one is, you know, if you had to tell your shareholders, say, hey, Mike, and when you get to the end of the day, what's the likely we're actually, as a company, going to be able to retain that IP and get return on that IP and not have to turn that over to our customer? I recognize that, but think about how difficult that conversation is. So you want us to invest cash today, make all these hurdles, there is no requirement, you got to jump all those hurdles, and at the end of the day you build something successful and you can't tell us if we're going to be able to retain the value for that investment we're making today. That makes that dialogue real hard. So what I find is the biggest challenge we have is basically working with the customers to build that market visibility so that we can meet our obligation to meet the value creation for all our stakeholders, including the customer, including the shareholder, be able to kind of connect that kill chain is the challenge. It's not the ideas. They exist.
You know, Al, on that point, I think, you know, the one of the things that we are not is we're not like a drug company. You know, if you're Amgen, you make these kinds of bets every day in your labs. You're doing research and you're making bets. You're spending billions to come up with a new treatment, a new drug, a new process that may or may not work, right? We all know the R&D is, if good R&D doesn't work sometimes, shouldn't work sometimes. But if they are successful, they have a patent protection for a while to help them recover that return on investment. There's no mechanism like that in our space.
However, their pricing also.
Yeah, I don't want to get into the healthcare discussion, but my point is that there's a structure there that does create an environment where companies are willing to try to make that investment because they believe there is a path to that return, and we don't have that. We don't really have that structure per se. You know, not in a big way.
And I think to Ellen's point, it does run counter to LPTA, lowest price, technically acceptable, right?
Right.
You know, that will drive us in the wrong direction if used inappropriately at times. Mm-hmm. I think we have time for one more question.
It's like generics.
Okay, excellent. Okay, the last question that I have is, what can OSD and the services do to help create better stability, better dialogue, and better predictability so that, in fact, we can deliver better mission capabilities?
I'm going to take that one. I'll start. I think we've talked a lot about here. One of the things that I think that we could do is I think I think we have a false assumption that our government customers, our senior customers, understand what motivates our business and how we fundamentally work. And I think our as an industry, we have a misunderstanding of what motivates and makes our senior customer work. The dialogue that we've had today, these are very discussable impediments that we have. As an industry, we want to make these investments. We want to, our employees love working for our customers. They love coming to work every day. They have a passionate, they want to deliver capability for the U.S. services. We want to make this happen. I think if we had greater dialogue and more discussions like this with our government customers to have greater understanding, it's like, what levers can we pull that would allow you to go to your shareholders and allow you to unlock more cash to deploy for these future innovations? What can we do as an industry government team to pull the right levers so that we can kind of unleash the capabilities that we have, both in terms of financial resources, but the technical resources to kind of move ahead? I think that would be the most important thing that we could do, align our incentives and pull some of the levers of our relationship so that we can be in a position that where we can invest more and satisfy our collective stakeholders.
Thank you, Jeff.
I think very simply, OSD needs to find a way to lean out their processes in order to determine that they have a compliant defense industrial base. It's getting to the same levels of compliance in a simpler, more streamlined fashion.
You know, I think that the folks in the OSD, the DoD acquisition piece, sit actually in a crossroads. They are at the intersection between our businesses, which operate on a return on investment principle, and a citizenship that operates on a fixed price budgeting process. So they are sitting right at that intersection, and they have to be the translators for that. They are also at the intersection, the other road that comes across is where the warfighters need and what the industrial base can provide. And so I think part of what they have to do is they have to recognize they're standing in the middle of an intersection. They're not spectators in the bleachers. They're not on the sidelines. They're in the crucible of this. It's kind of hard to be the Monday morning quarterback and say, okay, now you're in the intersection. Here's what I would do if I were you. But I think that the whole purpose that we do all of this stuff is for the warfighter. And so you have to start with what is it that the operations folks need and can use. And it's simple, something as simple as fill in the blank. Wouldn't it be great if, fill in the blank, and have the warfighter say that, and then go back to the taxpayers, the industry, the acquisition system, and say, let's do that.
Excellent.
I think we should give our panelists a big hand. This was a superb conversation. Well, for all our panelists and our moderator, we think it's appropriate, given the theme, the maritime theme of our conference every year, to give them a Naval Institute guide to ships and aircraft of the United States Navy. I think there'll be some ships in there that they may recognize, but it's apropos. It's a Naval Institute Press book, and also inside is an AFSEA bookmark to represent the collaboration between our two organizations to bring this event. Again, when we envisioned this panel, we envisioned at the best what we saw today. This was absolutely outstanding. Thank you very much.
Thank you.